And I hope, well, boy, I got to live up to that great introduction that Nick gave me. As she said, I'm Mary Marsh, and I am affiliated with the HR group here in Greensboro, doing contract human resources work. And a lot of it, I've been with the HR group now since 2003. And a lot of the work that I have done for the HR group is around compensation, although I have a background as a generalist and HR manager, and sorted other areas actually in HR. It seems that there are not a lot of compensation people out there, I guess, and so it's turned out to be a very good sort of area to be in as a contract person. And it's also something where companies, unless they're very large, really can't afford to have a dedicated compensation person on their staff, so it's good in that regard as well. Prior to joining the HR group, I worked with a company called Syngenta Crop Protection. You may have passed their headquarters out on Route 40, and I spent about 30 years in the agricultural chemical industry with Syngenta and some of its predecessors back up in Delaware, where I'm originally from. And I left there as the North American Director of Compensation and Relocation. Welcome. And as Nikki said, please do ask any questions along the way. I'd like it to be interactive. I'll throw out a few questions to you, and hopefully we can have some conversation. Just even to start off, are there any questions around compensation? And we're really going to focus a lot on compensation design, of course, tonight. Any questions that you have right up front that you would really like to make sure that we answer tonight? Otherwise, we'll just plunge in, and I'll hope that I answer all those secret questions that I know are lingering back there and you just don't want to ask. A lot of what we will talk about tonight really is, you know, focused on compensation design, but I did want to start off just to clarify some compensation terms, which some of them I'm sure you've seen or you will see elsewhere in this class. But just to clarify, I mean, the first one, salary, base pay, that one's pretty straightforward. The next one is total cash compensation. And technically, in the textbooks and all that, that would be your base salary plus bonus. Then there's one called total compensation. Again, kind of in the textbooks, they will often refer to total compensation, meaning base plus bonus plus benefits. These two terms can be very confusing, especially if you're working in salary survey data, any kind of published salary survey data. Generally, they will show two numbers. They will show base salary and they will show total compensation. It's really total cash compensation, so you just have to realize that sometimes you got to pay attention to which term people are using. In salary survey data, they'll say total compensation and it's really just total cash. And then the last one, which is a relatively new term, is one called total rewards. You don't in practice hear a lot about that still, but it's kind of gaining momentum. And that's really the whole package. It's the monetary pieces, the non-monetary pieces, you know, how the company's culture fits in, everything that makes your company hopefully a place that people want to work. So it's not just only about money. So just wanted to clarify those terms up front. This is actually a pretty interesting time, I would say, to be talking about compensation and compensation design because of what's going on right now, certainly with the economy. There are things in compensation that, quite frankly, in our lifetimes are unprecedented in terms of what we're seeing as far as some of the salary freezing. I mean, overall, potentially salary reductions. There's a lot of stuff going on right now that's pretty remarkable. I'll touch on it. I mean, the basic concepts in compensation design are still the same, but certainly what's going on right now with the economy is having some impact on some of the outcomes of what you do with comp design. So I'll talk a little bit as we touch on things during the session of where the economy may be having a bit more impact right now that we wouldn't typically see. When we look at what we're trying to do in compensation design, and we say that it's basically, you know, if you're going in there and you're tasked with designing a pay structure for your organization, you're going to do compensation design or a redesign potentially. What you're trying to achieve with your compensation program are all of these things. Certainly the key one, attract, motivate, retain. You hear that a lot in HR, certainly. The second one is your compensation program needs to be fiscally responsible. In other words, you got to be able to afford it. I think we could argue right now that there are certainly some companies who probably have neglected making sure that their compensation program was, in fact, fiscally responsible over the last who knows how long. I'd say maybe the U.S. automakers could be an example of where their comp and benefits programs are not proving right now to be a fiscally responsible situation. Part of that, and it's a good time to raise that, is because, of course, they do have union issues. They have union contracts that are dictating their pay and benefit structures. A lot of really basically what we'll talk about today in comp design is assuming that you're not doing it in a union environment, that you have the ability to make the decisions as to what's best for your company. In addition, your program needs to be competitive externally with the market so that you can, of course, attract and retain people. You need to also be aware and make sure that it is internally equitable, especially in any categories that may be discriminatory. You need to do some checks occasionally and make sure that you are, in fact, being fair and equitable in how you pay your folks internally. Needs to be understandable. It needs to be understandable to your managers who have to administer the compensation, as well as to some extent to your employees. That obviously varies as to how much different employers share with their employees about their compensation program. And then lastly, I'm not sure you all can see clear to the bottom there, it needs to be aligned with your company's strategy and culture, and we'll talk a little bit more about that shortly. Let's say for a moment that you are the HR manager at your company and you're going to hire in somebody. How do you decide what salary to offer that person? Where do you get that information from? How do you make that decision? If you are in a company that already has a compensation program, a pay and grade structure, it's very easy. We're relatively easy. As long as you know what your job you're hiring that person for, you can look at what's already in existence. You'll have pay ranges, and we're going to talk about that as we go through tonight and figure that out. Sometimes, if there's no pay structure currently in place, you will just literally look at what other people in your organization are getting paid and go, okay, we'll pay them this much. You can go out and get salary survey data. We're certainly going to talk about that this evening. And sometimes, whether there's a compensation program in place or not, and no matter what your salary survey does, sometimes it'll be whatever that manager says it's going to be. And those are some of the tough things that sometimes HR folks get into, but it's a reality that sometimes that will happen. Assuming you have the opportunity to actually design and put in place a compensation program for your organization, I think there are really three things basically that you need to have in order to put together your compensation design. And the first of those is job descriptions, and I'm sure you have talked or will talk about those sometime during this course. So I won't really go into that tonight other than to, again, emphasize that throughout what you do with compensation and paying people, it's always around paying for the job and not the person. So it's a key to keep in mind. The second piece that I think is really important, and a lot of companies kind of bypass this one, I think you really need to know what your company's compensation philosophy is. I think you need to put it in writing, because otherwise not all the folks in the management may actually think you're aiming at the same thing. Or if you don't have it in writing, you may not remain true to your philosophy. So I strongly support with my clients that they actually get a written compensation philosophy in place. And what that means is that you really need to decide where you want to be competitive in the market. How are you going to compare? Are you going to be a high payer, a low payer? And there are situations where you can get a, you know, you can actually be a low payer. As well as looking at the mix. You've got your base pay, you've got your variable or bonus pay, you've got your benefits. It's the balance between all of those pieces that makes up your total compensation program. So it's important before you really go into your design to know what it is you're trying to achieve in the end, where it is you want to be competitive. And then the last one, I think, that we'll talk quite a bit about today is to have some kind of survey data so you know whether what you're paying is, in fact, competitive. Touching a little bit more on this idea of compensation philosophy and what that means, this slide has three examples, really, of different companies with very different compensation philosophies. And one of them, everybody, of course, has heard of General Electric. At General Electric, it's a dog-eat-dog, very competitive internal culture at that company. At a place like General Electric, you have the opportunity to be paid above market. You can get paid really well at General Electric, but you really have to perform in order to get it. Very dog-eat-dog competitive environment. The second one in possibility is it's a very creative agency. It's actually a local company, a very hip, cool culture. Folks, you know, they got flex time. You can wear whatever you want to wear to work. It's the kind of culture where, in fact, a company can get away with being less than competitive on base pay and potentially even on base plus bonus, because there's a culture there that can attract the kind of people you want to your organization and actually keep them there. That money's not everything and the culture is a big draw. So that organization happens to have fairly average to low pay and benefits. And then the last one is another example, and it's just a bank. And banks, they have the culture that banks have. Banks tend not to be overall real high payers, and when I say that, you look at a bank and there's differences. Banks have HR people and banks have IT people. And when they look at folks like that, they're competing against all sorts of industries. So for those kind of folks in the general market, they're not paying at the highest level of competitiveness. However, the banks generally have really great benefits. And people will go to the banks, not so much for the base pay, which is on the lower side, but they'll go there for the better benefits. Underneath of all this, you have to realize if we look at the bank scenario, for example, like I said, on an IT person or an HR person, they're competing outside of the realm of banking. They're competing against all industries, potentially, for that talent. When you're a bank, though, you also, of course, have to, if you're looking for a loan collector, a loan officer, you're competing against other banks for that talent. Then you're in a situation where all the banks are not paying really high, but they've all got really great benefits. So you've got to look at how are you going to compete and differentiate yourself within your own industry as well for your compensation in that kind of situation. So there's a lot of things to look at in terms of your philosophy and your mix of all the parts of compensation. I wanted to touch next on salary survey data, which is, as I said, I think it's a key to making sure that you're paying competitively. Otherwise, you're kind of just pulling numbers out of the air. And really, I've worked with some clients, and they'll admit it up front. They pulled the numbers out of the air. And sometimes you see some really wild-looking things with salaries. It can be quite entertaining, and there's always a story behind it. But basically, these folks have gotten to the point where they've, you know, realized that they don't really know what they're doing. They don't know if they're competitive salary-wise in the marketplace. And so that's why they'll call me in and go, we need to get some competitive data. We need a pay structure. We need to get some control around our compensation plan. And the companies that I've worked with companies everywhere from ones that are big enough, they've got a pay structure, they've got access to survey data, they just don't have sort of the time and expertise to put it together. to companies who literally have nothing. They have absolutely just pulled salaries out of the air, have no idea if they're competitive, don't know what they're aiming at, and just have realized they just have to get some control and put some structure in place. So it's all over the place. But I really think that survey data is absolutely critical. And there are a lot of places that you can get it. Smaller companies in particular, it's still a challenge to get good survey data, but there's a lot of places you can go if you need to pull some survey data. The first one on there is industry surveys. And if you're in an industry that has an industry survey, your industry group puts together a salary survey, and there's a lot of industries out there that do that. To my mind, that is absolutely the best thing that you can have. Assuming that your industry, they get enough participants in the data to make it valid. It's targeted to your industry, so you can match up jobs that you won't be able to match up to any other generic surveys. The other thing about the industry survey is not only is it well targeted to your jobs, but generally these are a lot less expensive than some of the other options that we'll talk about later. So they're excellent if you can get them and their participation is sufficient. There are some professional organizations that also do surveys, a couple which you may be familiar with, the Society for Human Resource Management, SHRM, of which certainly Nikki and I are members, and some of you may be as well. They do some salary surveys. Another organization called World at Work. World at Work used to be called the American Compensation Association, and basically it's a professional organization more targeted toward comp and benefits people. So they do a lot, some survey work, and you'll find organizations, you know, accountants, National Association of Accountants or whatever. Some of the organizations like that will do professional organization surveys. Sometimes a little bit with like World at Work, they'll do, you know, non-HR jobs, general surveys. Certainly if you're looking at the Accounting Association, they're just looking at accountants, or you'll find ones for IT people, that kind of thing. But at least it's a start. Hopefully you're looking for salaries for accountants, at least you can kind of find some of that stuff. The next category is purchased surveys, and by that I mean there are quite a few providers out there, some of them very large, whose job, what they do is they're professional salary survey providers, basically. The data that you can get from a lot of these organizations is absolutely the best in terms of being reliable. You can be sure that the jobs are matched correctly, as far as not just looking at titles, and we'll talk about that a little bit. The sample sizes are very large, so the data is very valid. You can usually get it broken down by geographies and that kind of thing. These are great, but some of them are just really ridiculously expensive. We had some actually that my employer, we purchased several, and there were some that are, you know, in the $10,000 per year range, and there are some more than that. So some of these are just incredibly expensive and out of the range of, you know, smaller companies.
Mary, I'll give you a good example. We've got a small plant up in Vancouver, in British Columbia, and I just wrote a check for $16,000 for a salary survey because we have not done one there in over 10 years.
Wow.
And it was time to do one, but we had to ante up.
Yeah, ante big time.
Yeah.
Whoa. And sometimes, I mean, you can reduce sometimes the cost of these things by participating, but that might mean you can get it from $10,000 down to $8,000. You know, so it's still, those are expensive. They are probably the best data that you can get. The survey data that Nikki mentioned that we'll look at later on, actually the company that I use is a company called Economic Research Institute, ERI. And they are one of the largest global providers of salary survey data. Their approach is a bit different, however, because what they actually do is consolidate data from many other people's surveys and put it in a computer and do all sorts of great statistical things to it. One of the advantages